Okay, so yesterday we talked about QR factorization, size reduction, the triple L algorithm. So in particular, triple L takes a basis B of a lattice L as input and returns a basis C of L such that the first vector is relatively short and it does it in polynomial time. So that's what we did yesterday. Okay, so now I'm going to be, so in particular, as it is the first basis vector, it has to be non-zero. So now I'm going to try to find shorter vectors. Okay, and to do this, I'm going to show you a fairly old algorithm, actually, called the enumeration algorithm. Maybe. It was invented by many different people independently, so including Kanaan in 83. Or Finkel and Post also in 83. Some people in communication theories, they reinvented it a bit later. And it solves the shortest vector problem. So it will find B in L non-zero, minimal, of minimal length, of minimal lengths. So in particular, B will be less than square root n times the determinant to the 1 over n. Okay, so how does it work? So we write B equal QR, as yesterday. Where this one is up triangular. And if you recall, the norm of BX is the norm of RX. Okay, so finding a short lattice vector is the same as finding an integer x such that an integer vector x such that bx is small, and it's the same as finding an integer vector x such that r times x is small. Okay, so I have my r factor r, and I want to find an integer vector x that minimizes the norm of rx. So I want a non-zero x, otherwise I get a zero vector. Okay, so now let's inspect what r times x looks like. So what is rx? Times x. So it looks like, so let me increase a little bit, zoom in. So here I have r and n xn. Okay, so it's the simplest of all the coefficients because R is triangular. It's nice to have a triangular matrix. Then the next simplest coefficient is the last but one. So it's R n minus 1, n minus 1 times x n minus 1 plus R n minus 1 n xn. Okay. And the more I move up, the more complicated the coefficients are. So which one am I going to do? Maybe I should draw this one, just so that you get a feeling of what happens. R n minus 2 n minus 2 x n minus 2 plus R n minus 2 n minus 1 x n minus 1 plus R n minus 2 n xn. And you can keep going. And the one on top, it has n quantities that I sum. Okay? So now I want to minimize this. So instead of minimizing, I'm going to do something even more brutal. I'm going to say I'm going to list all the vectors with the norm bounded below something. Such that the norm of Rx is below some b for a well chosen b. Okay. So in particular, if b is above square root n determinant to the 1 over n, I have a non-empty set of B axes, or R axes, and in particular, in this set, there is the shortest non-zero vector. So if I have the full list of short vectors, I can just take the shortest among them, and that will be a shortest non-zero vector in the lattice. Okay. So for example, I can take B equal B1. Okay. So at least I will have the vector B1. And I will have all vectors smaller than B1. So in particular, the shortest non-zero vector. Okay, so how am I going to do this? So to list all these short vectors, I'm going to exploit the explicit form of R times X. So in particular, if Rx is smaller than B, the last coordinate of Rx must be smaller than B. It's a short vector, so in particular, its last entry has to be short. And now this is equivalent to xn less than b divided by rnn. So the ris are strictly positive. I can remove the absolute values. So xn, the last integer, belongs to an interval. So it's between minus b over rnn and plus b over Rnn. And it's an integer. So it's an integer that belongs to an interval. There is only a finite number of possibilities. This enumeration algorithm will try them all. I'm not saying it's a very clever algorithm. It's a fairly brutal one. Okay, so let's assume I have chosen one xn. So try them all. And now assume now that one of these xn's has been chosen. Okay. So I'm done with the choice of xn. It's temporarily chosen. So I'm going to try them all, but at some stage there is a fixed value. Now let's look at the last but one coordinate of Rxn, of Rx. Okay, so the last but one coordinate is Rn minus 1 n minus 1 xn minus 1 plus Rn minus 1 n xn. So in particular, Rx smaller or equal to b implies that Rn minus 1 n minus 1 xn minus 1 plus Rn minus 1 n xn is smaller than b. Okay, so that looks like a complicated inequality, but in fact not at all, because these are fixed now. This is fixed. So this I can rewrite as xn minus 1 is an integer that belongs to an interval. Okay, so to be more explicit, xn minus 1 plus Rn minus 1 n over Rn minus 1 n minus 1 times xn smaller than b over Rn minus 1 n minus 1. Okay. So it belongs to an interval of side lengths 2b over Rn minus 1 n minus 1 and center minus Rn minus 1 n divided by Rn minus 1 n minus 1 times xn. So there are, and I know the center because I know R, I know xn, I've chosen it. So I can just exhaustively search for all these xn minus ones. Okay, so at most 2b over R n minus 1 n minus 1 plus 1 choices for xn minus 1. For every choice of xn. Okay, and you can keep going like this. So once you've set xn and xn minus 1, you can browse for all the possibilities for xn minus 2. So by doing the same, you have at most 2b over R n minus 2, n minus 2, plus 1, choices for xn minus 2, for every choice of xn, comma, xn minus 1. Okay, so that gives you an idea of the algorithm. So pick xn, try all xn minus 1s, for each xn, xn minus 1, try all xn minus 2s, and so on and so forth. So in total, so you have sum for I equal 1 to n. So I is a current index. So for example, I start with n, and then I do I equal n minus 1, I equal n minus 2. And for each I, they are product for j equal I to n of 1 plus 2b over rjj. so at most this. Choices of xi to xn. So it comes from where I start the tuple. Okay, so for xn, you have 1 plus 2b over rnn. Then for xn minus 1, you have 1 plus 2b over rn minus 1 n minus 1 times 1 plus 2b over rnn. And so on and so forth.
It's a product, right? So the amount of possibilities there for.
Like this. Because it depends where I start my tuple. So the number of possibilities for xi to xn is this. And then if I go for all possible i's, I need to add the sum. Or some i. Okay, so I will insist a little bit on this actually. Okay, so what is this algorithm? So if you abstract it a little bit, it's a tree search. Okay, so you start with a tree with some level, so it's more like a forest because there is not a single node at the top. So these are all the possible xn's. Okay, and for each possible xn, you have a bunch of possible xn minus 1's. So these are the possible tuples xn minus 1 xn. Okay, so for each choice of xn, you have a few possibilities for xn minus 1. And then we keep going. So these are the possible xn minus 2, xn minus 1, xn's. Okay, and you keep going. And at the end, so it's something happened here. And at the end, you have the possible x1 to xn. Okay, so that means in particular all the vectors x such that r times x is smaller than b. Okay, so if you have all the leaves, in particular one of these leaves gives you a shortest non-zero lattice vector. Okay, so I want to make a few remarks here. My tree search was very dumb, as I described it, because I said, okay, I start with all xn's, and then all xn minus 1 xn's, and then all xn minus 2 xn minus 1 xn's. And this requires a memory which is the size of the tree. So if I do level by level, I'm building the whole tree, and the space complexity is essentially the same as the time complexity. Don't compute the tree. Okay, but instead you do depth first. So you try 1xn, and then 1xn minus 1, you go down, and then up, then you browse, you go up, and so on. So you do depth first instead. Okay, so in particular, if you depth first, now the memory is only, so if I want all possible x's such that Rx is smaller than b, the memory will only be the size of the bottom layer. Okay, but in fact, I don't even need this, because if I'm interested in the best solution, I don't need to keep track of all the x's I've found so far. I only need to keep track of the best x that I've found so far. Then the memory is just poly. Any question on this? Still relatively clear. Okay, so that's one remark that I wanted to do on the tree. Just do depth first and only keep the best solution so far, and that gives you polynomial space complexity. The runtime, there is no miracle. It's still the size of the tree, because you browse the whole tree, so it's the runtime is still bigger. Also, with this view, you can see you can parallelize very fast. You just look at subtrees and distribute them on different machines. So all this is going to be very efficient in practice to implement. One important remark related to the question that I had on the sum is that, as opposed to some kind of intuition that you may have on the tree, the biggest level in the tree is usually not the bottom level. So here, I mean, the tree starts by increasing, but in fact it increases, and very often it shrinks at the end. So that means you have plenty of branches in this tree that are dead branches. So you have a tuple xi to xn, and then there is no choice for xi minus 1. Because the interval that you are looking at has become too small, or there is no option for xi minus 1, and it's a dead branch. Okay, so that can happen. So it's why it's very important to have this sum, because this sum somehow takes the max of the sizes of all the levels. And in particular, because the maximum level may be somewhere in the middle, the sum is much larger than the quantity with just the product starting from 1 to n. Okay, so let's try to look at the cost of this. So this gives a number of nodes, and what you can check is that going from one node to another in the tree is efficient. It's just computing some arithmetic formula. So it's all it's polynomial time, one tree node from another. So this gives a bound on the time complexity. Okay, and for example, we could assume that before we run the enumeration, we did triple L, because triple L is polynomial time, it cleans up the basis, so why not do triple L before? Okay, so cost when the input B, I have two B's. When the input basis is triple L reduced. Okay, and I set the enumeration bound to B1. Okay, so I'm going to exhaustively look for the vectors smaller than B1 in norm, which is R11. Okay. So now the cost is bounded by the sum for I equal 1 to n of the product for j equal I to n of 1 plus 2r11 over rjj. Okay. And there is a very important property for triple L reduced basis. It's exactly how triple L was designed. It's that the RIIs don't decrease too fast. The decrease of the RIIs is bounded. That's the whole design principle of triple L. Okay, so R11 over RJJ, that cannot be too small. Because RJJ is not arbitrarily small compared to R11. So in particular, this quantity, yesterday we bounded it by 2 to the j minus 1. By triple L reducedness. Okay, so if I multiply by 2, I get 2 to the j. And 1 plus 2 to the j, I'm going to say it's smaller than 3 to the j because I'm lazy. Okay, so all this, smaller than 3 to the J. It's not a tight bond anyway, so as it's not tight, I can be lazy. Okay, so all this is smaller than the sum for I equal 1 to n of the product J equal I to n of the 3 to the J. Okay, and it's not tight from anywhere, so I can look at the largest product here. So the largest product here is for j equal 1. So I get the product of the 3 to the j's from j equal 1 to n. And the largest j that I have in this product is n. Okay, so I'm really not subtle here. So it's less than n times because of the sum. And the largest term is 3 to the n square for the product. Okay, so obviously you can improve this constant quite a bit. What I want to say is that it's 2 to the big O of n square. Okay, so that's the cost of enumeration when you start from a triple L reduced basis. It actually matches in practice, this upper bound. Well, not to the constant term, but the quadratic term in the exponent you can observe in experimentally. Okay, so that gives an SVP algorithm. So it gives the shortest vector problem algorithm. This algorithm can be boosted by doing more preprocessing than triple L. And to do more preprocessing than triple L, you use this enumeration recursively. Okay, so there is a way to use enumeration recursively to do better than triple L as a preprocessing, and that would eventually help the final enumeration. So this ID was due to Canaan. So use enumeration to preprocess. As a replacement to triple L. And if you do this, you can lower the 2 to the big O of n squared to down to 2 to the big O of n log n. And if you want to improve the time complexity, then you have to switch to other types of algorithms. So as far as we know, for this algorithm, we don't know how to go below 2 to the n log n. So some people fight with a constant, but that's essentially it. The n log n is still there. If you want to go below 2 to the n log n, then you have to use another type of algorithms called the sieving algorithms. Find the shortest non-zero vector. In time and space, 2 to the big O of n. So you improve time, but then your space complexity also blows up. So this is due to Itai. So it started with Itai, Kumar, and Sivakumar. In 2001. So it's not too hard to describe also, but I'm not going to do it here. Because it doesn't use a QR factorization, and I wanted to use a QR factorization. So in practice, enumeration is the best up to dimensions, I don't know, 60, 70, this kind of dimensions. And now it has been taken over by sieving, which manages to solve the shortest vector problem up to dimensions 160 in a reasonable amount of time, maybe a bit more. So there are actually plenty of work on this, on the asymptotic and also experimental aspects of SVP solving. So there is a beautiful article by Elena and others at Eurocrypt that I warmly recommend on sieving. And there is lots of experimental aspects to it also, just to run the things and make it work in very high dimensions. Okay, so at this stage, what do we have? So we have D1 over delta vel to the 1 over n. So we can achieve, so how to put it? And time. Okay, so with triple L, I mean polytime. And here I achieve 2 to the big O of n. It's efficient, but the approximation factor is exponential. Or I can use, say, sieving. And then I pay 2 to the big O of n. But here I achieve square root n. Okay, so on one end, you pay an exponential amount, you get something extremely short. On the other end of the spectrum, you pay polynomial time, and you get an exponential approximation factor. Okay, so a natural question is whether there is something in between. Okay, can you pay more than triple L and get a lower approximation factor? Okay. So the answer is yes. And this was an area that was started by Schnorr. In 87, I think. And that has been improved a lot afterwards. So in particular, there is something which is used a lot today, which is BKZ. For this, one uses BKZ. For block Corkins or OTRF. I'm not going to explain the name. So Corkins or OTRF, I'm not going to explain. Block, I'm going to explain. And it's from 91. And it's a practical version of Schnorr 87, which was proposed by Schnorr and Reuschner. Okay, so how does that work? So look at your R factor. So we saw yesterday that the off-diagonal coefficients, we don't care about them too much. What matters is to prevent the diagonal coefficients from decreasing too fast. Okay, and what we said yesterday is that, okay, we are going to use the two-dimensional algorithms on the diagonal. Okay, so you look at two vectors, you do some things with them to balance locally. And whatever you do locally in dimension 2, you can repeat a lot of times on the diagonal so that it has a global effect. Okay, so that's triple L. You do stuff in dimension 2 locally, you repeat it many times everywhere on the diagonal, and it flattens everything. Okay, so BKZ extends this two-dimensional block into a k-dimensional block, where k is a parameter of the algorithm. You go from 2 to k. Okay, so k is a parameter. It goes from 2 to n. So if you want to be in the triple L regime, you take k equal 2. If you want to do in an extreme regime, very close to enumeration, you take k equal n. And in between, you have all the possible k's. So what do you do for this k? So you take this block. You take it out. Okay, so it's still k. So that defines a k-dimensional lattice. And what you do on it is to run some SVP solver. Okay, so maybe you run the enumeration, maybe you run sieving. It doesn't really matter. What matters is that you find a very short vector and the lattice spanned by these k columns. Okay. So you update, so this gives you one vector that you put in front, and the others you don't really matter. So you clean up the rest so that it's still a basis, somehow, but you keep the short vector in front. Okay, so you go from to some RU, which starts with a shortest vector. So this one has norm less than square root k times determinant of the block to the 1 over k. And then you put other vectors. They don't matter too much. Okay, so what do you do with this block that, for which you find the shortest non-zero vector? So now you get back to the initial R. You apply a transformation matrix in dimension n whose effect is to update the current the block of importance. So all the vectors you keep, and here you put U. So if U is unimodular, this extended matrix is also unimodular. And the effect of this is to keep everyone. So all this is the same as before. All this is the same as before. And here it's updated, and in particular, this guy is very short because that's the norm of the first basis vector in the updated block. Okay. So what did you do by doing this? So triple L, it takes two vectors and does some local fiddling in dimension 2. And it's efficient because it's dimension 2, but doesn't have a lot of effect because in dimension 2, there is not such much room to spend a lot of computational effort and make things very small. What it does here is that it takes a bigger block, so it's more expensive because you do some SVP solving in dimension k, so that costs you 2 to the k. But the first vector now is the shortest non-zero vector in a k-dimensional lattice. And that's much better than the shortest non-zero vector in a two-dimensional lattice. Being short in dimension in a dimension k lattice, that's a much more demanding condition than being short in a two-dimensional lattice. Okay, so in particular, you are much shorter than whatever triple L would have found with two-dimensional blocks here. Okay, so this guy, you really pushed a lot to make it short. Okay, so more than with triple L. Okay, so what do you do once you've done a block? So that's the general strategy of Schnorr 87. So you take a block, you spend more effort on it, and then the question is which blocks do you choose? Okay, so BKZ has a very stupid but effective strategy. So you take the vectors from 1 to k, and then 2 to k plus 1, and then 3 to k plus 2. Okay, so you take the first k, and the next bunch of k, and the next bunch of k, and so on, until you get to n minus k plus 1 up to n. Okay, so you are towards the end, and then you finish off the rest by doing n minus k plus 2 up to n, so this is dimension k minus 1, n minus k plus 3 up to n, to n minus 1 n. Okay, so you do all these blocks. And because this may not be enough, at the end of this you restart. I like to call it the rolling pin algorithm. So if you take, if you want to do bread and you have your rolling pin, you need to flatten the paste. And that's exactly what BKZ is doing. It takes the rolling pin, it pushes a lot, and it flattens by doing tours. Okay. So that's what triple L does. BKZ does. And actually, it's very effective in practice. So the analysis of this is a bit tricky. Somewhat tricky analysis. Which I'm not going to do here. What I'm going to state is the conclusion of the story. for time 2 to the big O of k. So that means you have a k-dimensional block. What you achieve in terms of b1 over det of l to the 1 over n. Goes as k to the big O of n over k. Okay, so think of k equal 2. So k equal 2 is triple L. K equal 2, you get time 2 to the big O of 1. So in fact, it's times poly. So you get poly time. But on the right-hand side, for k equal 2, you get 2 to the n. Okay, same as before. Now, if you take k equal n, so you're on the other extreme regime, so you have only one block for k equal n, so you just do your SVP. For k equal n, you get time 2 to the n, and approximation factors, n to the big O of 1, which turns out to be square root n in this case. Okay, so you have the two extreme regimes, like 2 to the n and good approximation factors, or poly n time and bad approximation factor. Okay, so for example, so here in this formula, this k doesn't matter so much. What matters more is whatever is in the exponent. Okay, the effect of this k is much bigger than the effect of that k, because in the, when you move this one in the exponent, it's a log k. Okay, so what I like to draw usually is this kind of curve. Which is doubly in log-log scale. So here is a log-log scale. Log-log time. No, log-log b1 over det to the 1 over n. And here I like to put log-log of time. Okay, so if you spend take k equal n, no, k equal 2, then this is 2 to the n, the log is n, and the log-log is 1, essentially. Okay, so you get 1. And this is triple L. Okay. If you take k equal n, then this becomes, in log-log, it becomes 0. But this becomes 1 in log-log. So you have this 1. And this is sieving. Okay, so now take k equal n to the alpha. So that's an interesting k. Then you get time 2 to the n to the alpha. And b1 over det of l to the 1 over n equal 2 to the soft o of n to the 1 minus alpha. Okay, so the soft O kills the k, this k, and there you have n divided by n to the alpha, that's n to the 1 minus alpha. So if you look at what happens in log-log, so in log-log this becomes alpha, and in log-log this becomes 1 over alpha, 1 minus alpha. Okay, so in log-log scale, you have this, this line, that's the BKZ line. And in particular, for 1/2, you get 1/2. Okay, so if you spend 2 to the n, 2 to the square root n in time, you get an approximation factor, which is 2 to the square root n. So that's where the approximation factor and time get equalized. Okay, so if you spend less, then you are here. If you spend more, you are down here. Okay. And putting a dent into this curve has been an open problem for since Schnorr, basically. So the only things that have happened since then are to improve the constants in front of the big O's. Yep.
Things there. So how? So for this result, which kind of was not used inside of?
So what I commented on is very asymptotic here, but it's actually very concrete also. So in BKZ, the runtime is essentially dependent on how do you solve SVP. I mean, that's really what consumes time. Then there is also the question of how many times you call it, but this is only polynomial. It's actually a small polynomial. So maybe in practice you do 5 tours and that's it. It's over. Okay, so in practice it's converging quite fast. So this is very relevant for cryptanalysis, for example, because this is the best known generic attack against lattice-based cryptography. So people want to know how much it costs. So in particular, people want to be able to extrapolate the cost of BKZ. So the general strategy at this stage is to say, okay, so BKZ is calling an SVP solver many times. I'm going to assume that it calls an SVP solver at least once. And I'm going to lower a bound by a single call to an SVP solver in dimension k. Okay. So the first thing is to decide k. Okay. So, but this is fairly well known, actually. Which k gives you which approximation factor? In practice, it's very accurate. So there is a very accurate formula of what happens. Because this Minkowski bound of square root n, up to a constant, it's sharp. On average, it's always square root n. And the constant in front of it is also known and very sharp. So there is an explicit constant involving pi and e and a square root. And this constant, it just turns out to be almost always true in practice. So people know what to expect for the output. So people know, so for a given b1, norm of b1, people know which k to choose. Okay? And once you have k, you say, okay, so the cost will be lower bounded by a single call to SVP in dimension k, and then you look at the best algorithms you have around for SVP solving. Yeah?
Should the LOL and C being labels be stopped?
Log time. Oh, yes. Good catch. So replace triple L and sieving. Sieving is on the top left and triple L is on the bottom right. Thank you. Any question on this? So I'm going to move on to some, yeah. So that depends how much you are willing to spend. That's so it's a Sphinx-like answer. So if you want something relatively efficient, you can take k equal 80. And you can use the FPLL library with k equal 80. That will be relatively fast. So you can experiment with such case easily, like on your own desktop. Sorry?
What do you mean by fast?
One block will be 1 second. Or a few seconds. Sorry?
For an average lattice
dimension 80. Yeah. For the blocks that appear inside BKZ with block size 80, each single block will be of the order of 1 second, maybe 10 seconds. So it's doable with 80. And if you want to push it more, then you need to use more specialized software, like the one that Elena developed, for example, contributed to developing. Then 150 maybe, but then you need a big cluster of machines, and you need specialized software, and memory, and so it's also very interesting, but then you are in the range of actual heavy computations, and if you want to push it more, then it's like high performance computing, and so you are starting asking other questions then. But 80 to play with is good. So something that people do a lot also is simulations. Because you can look at the log of the RIIs, like we started looking at yesterday afternoon in the tutorial session. And you can simulate what an SVP call does on the curve. And for this, you don't need to run the SVP. You know what is the expected norm of the output. So you can simulate what will happen. Okay, and these simulations, so they are very efficient because there is no SVP running, and you can run with super large block sizes. So for small block sizes, you can check that the simulations match with experiments. So in dimension 80 up to 100, you can check that it fits. And then you can run simulations with a block size 10,000, which is insane, but...
Are you sure that it's relevant? Because, I mean, something like that is when the LL works really well on low dimensional lattice, so if you extrapolate, I mean, below the LL,
yeah,
LL should work for 10,000.
Yeah, so there is always a small input effect. So you are never prevented from this. I mean, maybe there is something that happens for block size 300 and more that we don't understand. And this won't be captured by simulation, because simulation is just telling you what we know today. So you cannot be 100% sure based on this. At the moment, simulation is fairly accurate for all the dimensions that we handle. It's a very useful tool also for experiments, because before actually running your experiment, you may want to simulate a bit to find a good strategy to run your experiment. Other questions? Okay, so I'm going to move to something completely different. The SIS problem. Introduced by Itai in 96. So Itai is essentially the father of lattice-based crypto. So he gave the first problems and the first primitives and so on. So it was mostly theoretical at the time, but now it has significant impact. Okay, so let's define it. Okay, so there is a bunch of parameters. So maybe I will draw a picture first and then give the definition. So you have a matrix A. For me, it's going to be a matrix like this. So I think I'm part of a minority now. And the majority takes a flat A rather than a tall A. So A has m rows, n columns, and the entries are defined mod Q. Okay. So that's it. I already have three parameters. To start with. So this is the input. Okay. And typically we say that it's chosen uniformly. Okay. So the output goal find x in z to the m, such that x a is 0 mod q. Okay, so x is in the kernel of a. So far, not very difficult. X equals 0 works. I'm assuming that x is non-zero. Still not difficult, because I can compute the kernel of A by just linear algebra and give you as many x's as I want. But I want a short x, smaller than some parameter beta. Okay. So, and that makes it hard. So 6 Q M beta, So now I give only three parameters because usually Q, N, M, and beta are all functions of N. Okay, so Q of N, M of N, and beta of N. Okay, so we have one parameter that drives hardness, it's N. And all the parameters, all the other parameters are functions of this main parameter N. Okay, so given A sampled uniformly with entries mod Q, M rows, and N columns, find X in the M such that X is smaller than beta and XTA equals 0 mod Q. Okay, so it's an average case problem. And I'm happy if I can solve this problem with non-negligible probability. I'm happy. So happy as a cryptanalyst. Which typically doesn't make everyone happy, but if I can solve this, with non-negligible probability, and probability is always over some randomness, so here it's over the randomness of A, over the random choice of A. And also over my internal randomness. Okay. So far so good. Huh? So that's a problem definition. Just find small elements in the kernel mod Q of a random matrix. It's not a crazy problem. Okay, so this is a lattice problem. Okay, so I define lambda Q perp of A as a set of X's in Z to the M such that XTA is equal to 0 mod Q. So my claim is that this is a lattice. Okay. Why is it a lattice? This should come from yesterday's tutorial. So it's construction A. Tutorial with code C defined as the orthogonal of A mod Q. Set of S's in ZQ, C's, sorry, ZQ to the M such that CTA equals 0 mod Q. Okay, so in coding theory, that would be the way you define the code from a parity check matrix. So A is a parity check matrix of the code, and you look at all the C's that are orthogonal to A mod Q that define the code, the orthogonal code of the code generated by A. And now, if we build the lattice from this code, then we get lambda q perp of A. So it's C plus QZM. Okay, so if you want a basis of this lattice, you start by computing a generating matrix for C. So using A, you do some linear algebra, you get a generating matrix for the corresponding parity check matrix. You get the generating matrix for C, and using this generating matrix for C, you apply the algorithms that we had during the last two tutorials to get a basis for the lattice. So in particular, if A has rank, okay, so let's assume that Q is prime. Okay, so Q prime is only for the health of mind. It's also, most of this is also true when Q is not prime, but then you need to think of it some more. So if Q is prime, and if A has rank N mod Q, which happens with overwhelming probability, also by the exercise from yesterday, then C has dimension, the codimension. So your parity check matrix has m rows and columns, so your code has dimension m minus n. And lengths M. Okay, so the determinant of A. So yesterday we saw that it was Q to the length minus the dimension of C. Okay, so it's Q to the M minus M minus N. So the M's, they disappear. Q to the M. Okay, so one way to formulate this is to say, okay, I have this lattice of solutions, and I'm interested in a short lattice vector. A lattice vector of norm at most beta. Okay, so it's a kind of SVP for a random lattice. So it's some SVP, shortest vector problem, some approximate SVP, because maybe it's not the shortest non-zero vector, for a random family of lattices. Okay, so I've got 5 minutes left, and I know what I want to do. we are going to run BKZ to see how much it costs to solve this. Okay. Okay, so BKZ with block size K. So what we saw is that for time 2 to the k, okay, so I'm forgetting about the constants in the exponent, but if you want to get the constant, you can just follow the reasoning and plug the proper constants wherever you want. So for time t, we get b1 with b1 over delta of l to the 1 over dimension less than k to the dimension over k. Okay, so here I'm putting dimension rather than n because putting n is a good way to make a mistake here. So it's really dimension that matters here. Because the n, there is an n in cis, but the n that is a parameter of cis is not the lattice dimension. The lattice dimension is m. Okay, so here, time 2 to the k, and b1 k would be less than k to the m over k times the determinant. So we saw what it was q to the n over m. Okay, so that's what BKZ spits out if I use the upper bound on the norm of the theoretical upper bound on the output. Okay, so here there is something to observe. This guy grows with m, whereas this one decreases with m. Okay, and there is a good reason for this. So if you increase m, your dimension increases, so the approximation factor of BKZ is exponential in the dimension. So it will increase as a function of the dimension. So increasing the dimension doesn't help in terms of approximation factor for BKZ. On the other hand, if you increase the dimension, the dimensions root of the determinant decreases, because the determinant is q to the n, whatever the value of m. So even if I increase m, the determinant is still q to the n. So this dimensions root of the determinant, it gets smaller and smaller as the m increases. So in particular, the shortest non-zero vectors, they grow like q to the n over m, they get smaller and smaller if I increase m. Okay, so there are two things that go against one another. One is that there are shorter vectors in the lattice, and the other one is that I have a worse approximation factor for solving. Okay, so they don't go in the right way. And what I want to add is that this m, you can tune in your algorithm. So for example, you have this matrix A. Which has some number of rows. If you find that there are too many rows, you can say, OK, I'm going to forget about this and compute a vector x, which is zero here. Okay. And if you force the last coordinates of x to be zero, it's as if the bottom of A was not existing. And you have reduced, you have decreased m artificially. Okay, so this, you can choose any m which is smaller than the m of your input in solving.
But it might be that there's no solution.
Yeah, it could be that, yeah. So for example, if you take a smaller m which is too small, this term becomes bigger than beta, so there's no solution. So, but you can tune a bit. So for simplicity here, I'm going to assume that the input matrix has a large m. Okay. So in particular, larger than the optimal value of M to minimize this upper bound. Okay, so. So what is this optimal value of M? So usually to get it, you just equalize. So you get M, say M star, over K times log K equal N log Q divided by M star, which gives you M star, the optimal M to minimize this quantity, equal square root, because you put the two M stars on the same side, it's an M star squared, so there is a square root involved. And now you have N log Q times K divided by log K. K N log Q. Okay. So in particular, I'm assuming that the M input is larger than this M star, which is equal to this. It's not unreasonable. Typically, M input is like N log Q. And here you have a square root of N log Q, so which is much less than N log Q, plus some term which is square root of K over log K, which typically is less than square root of N log Q. Okay, so this is typically less than the input M. Okay, so this choice of M star, that's really artificial for the analysis, because it turns out that LLL does it automatically for you. BKZ does it automatically for you. So it will find vectors that corresponds to this M star. So it's quite artificial, it's only here for the analysis. If you forget it experimentally, that doesn't matter. It's taken care of by BKZ. Okay, so now I can plug this M star into the upper bound on B1. For this M star, okay, so when I replug, I don't need to compute both terms because that's exactly how M star was computed. M star was computing so that both terms are equal. So I'm not going to plug M star in both quantities, only one. Okay, and then I get two to a square root of N log Q log K divided by K. Up to a factor 2 in the exponent because I have two terms, but I've already given up with the constants a long time ago. So. Okay, and our goal to solve this is B1 smaller than beta. Okay, so I plug beta equals this thing. So it's easier to say 2 to the log beta equals this. Okay, because now I need to choose k. So far, I don't know how much it costs because I've not chosen k. So I need to choose the block size. Okay, so I get log beta equal log square beta. I'm removing the square. Equal n log k, n log q times log k over k. My goal is to find k, so k over log k equal n log q over log square beta. Okay, and when you have x over log x equal y, it's the same as x equal y log y. X over log x equal y means x equal y log y. Okay, so that's the same. K equal n log q over log square beta times log of n log q log square beta. Okay, so in particular the runtime is 2 to this k, so it's n log q over log square beta to Z n log Q over log square beta. Okay, that's a bit of an ugly formula. The exponent matters much more than the rest. I mean, this matters more than this. I mean, this, it's x log x, and in x log x, x matters more than log x. Okay, so this term is really the most important one. So the hardness increases with n, not a surprise, I would say. It increases with q. Maybe that's somewhat less intuitive. It decreases with beta, because if you have a larger beta, it's easier to find vectors of norms smaller than beta. Okay, so that shows how the hardness goes with the different parameters. And also, there is a typical choice. So the typical choice is Q equal poly of N, M equal N log Q, and beta equal poly of N. Okay, so that's the most frequent choice of parameters. Okay, and if I plug this, so this M is large enough so that the M star is below M. And in this case, so you plug things, so this is N log N divided by log square N. And here, so N log N divided by log square N, it's N over log N. And here is a log of itself. So log of n over log n, that's essentially log n. So you have n over log n divided by log square n times log n. So all this just to make all the log to make all the logs disappear. Okay, so you have one log n, two log n's, and one more log n. So all the logs are gone, and that's 2 to the n. Yeah. Okay. So this is it for today. Tomorrow I will do more of this, and in particular I will explain Lyubashevsky's signature. So I will do a signature algorithm whose security relies on the presumed hardness of this.